does exist, there is a window here. It won't be open long, and Benir will have gotten away with it.
I don't feel comfortable letting you go in there alone.
I'm not helpless.
It's his life, his choice, but no matter how this turns out, it will end badly for you.
We got him scared now.
He's been thinking about it for 20 years.
It ends when you die.
If I'm not out in an hour, do whatever you want. Guys like that don't just die.
Okay, it's Nicolas Cage, it's Paul Schrader, a winning combination that has worked before. Bringing Out the Dead is one of my favorite Nick Cage movies, and in this one you have Cage as a former CIA agent with dementia who's hunting down a terrorist who tortured him about 22 years prior. So how could this movie possibly go wrong? This is a movie that actually has kind of a depressing backstory, it seems. This, by all accounts, should be a really good movie. There's a lot of good elements there. It seems like it was originally intended to be an ambitious film. It's a little like Serena in regards to, like, not in that it's as badly entertaining as Serena was, but in that you can tell that there is probably a good movie in there somewhere. Like, this probably started out fine, and then the movie was taken away from the director and hacked to fucking pieces down to about a 90-minute Tom Clancy knockoff, and then just thrown onto video on demand and iTunes and limited engagement in theaters. You can tell that by looking in this. The same way you could tell by a lot of sequences in Serena, where Serena had what were obviously scenes, but just kind of edited together in a montage, and because of that you don't have very good character development or story development. There's a lot of that here in this movie, and it's a shame, because it is, because you don't want to dislike a Paul Schrader movie with Nick Cage where he's hunting down some fucking bad guys, and yet here we are talking about Dying of the Light. Except for Lloyd. He looks like he wants out. Come on, buddy. I'll be done in a few. Okay. So, anyway, where was I? Oh, yeah, back to talking about this piece of shit. The movie has been widely protested by people who have made it, by the director, by the cinematographer, by the actors in the movie. And it's like this silent protest. I guess Schrader's script has been around for a little while, at least, because originally it was developed as a Harrison Ford movie with Nicholas Winding Refn attached to it as director, but then he went off to go do Drive, and so Paul Schrader was going to direct his own script, but Refn is still, he's still listed it as an executive producer. But the protest of the movie is, if I read correctly, it's that it's a silent protest in which they were going around wearing t-shirts that basically address the clause in their contract stating that you can't verbally say anything negative about the film. And so they haven't verbally said anything bad about the film. They're just wearing it all over their shirts between Cage, Schrader, Refn as well, I believe, and Anton Yelchin, who's also in the movie. And I know the obvious joke is that, like, really, of all movies, Cage is protesting this one? And I get it, because, okay, yeah, you got Cage movies like Outcast, Left Behind, things like that that aren't very good, but why would you even bother protesting something like that? Like, okay, he did those movies because of a paycheck. He said yes to everything that came to him for the financial whatever. And so, Yoko, why would you even protest that? You're just doing it for a check. You're gonna have a romp in this kind of cheesy, shitty movie. All right, whatever. In this, where it is clear that, like, they really wanted to do this, Schrader, Cage, Yelchin, all of these people, Refn, really thought that they had something here. And yeah, when that is taken away from you and just hacked to fucking pieces, something that you had a lot of interest in, oh yeah, I definitely see wanting to protest that way more than something you would if you had no seated interest in or any kind of ambition or anything in any way, shape, or form. The movie's just, it's got so many, honestly, it does have problems that would probably exist regardless of whatever hack job was done by the editors. There are problems with the story here. I mean, there are definitely problems with the editing. There's problems with the cinematography. This does not look like a Paul Schrader movie. This doesn't look and feel like one. Apparently, because one of the people speaking out against the movie is the cinematographer, who also complains that the movie was taken away from him and made to digitally look like shit. So yeah, this movie does not feel like it is the same guy who brought the same director who brought us American Gigolo and Hardcore and some great movies like that. Like even some of my least favorite Schrader movies, I could still easily say, like, well, okay, yeah, that still looks like a Paul, just looks and feels like a Paul Schrader movie. This one, no, it looks like it's just edited to be shown late at night on Showtime with this really stock soundtrack that doesn't work and some really choice editing. Like, whoever edited this movie, whoever was the guy who just like, well, we're just gonna edit this down to 90 minutes and just fucking shit it out there so people can see it, man, boy, you can fucking tell that they don't care, because performances in the movie are by and large fine. You can see where there's some good acting work in this movie, but at the same time there's no care really put into what choice of lines that they're gonna use for the actors. So a line might come out sounding really awkward, and you're left there wondering, A, if this movie wasn't taken away from the director, would this line even still be there? And B, I'm sure this probably isn't the take that they would have gone with. But there are other legitimate problems with the movie. Other than clearly there's some post-production difficulties between the producers and the director and whoever financed and distributed this film. Like I said, the movie is Nicolas Cage plays Evan Lake, a guy who was tortured by a terrorist sometime in the 90s, and this is just really quickly shown at the beginning of the movie, and then later on in really awkwardly placed flashbacks. It's like, I know there was probably originally some big build-up here to where that is probably not originally the opening scene in the movie, and it also probably wasn't supposed to be awkwardly just thrown in there along with whatever it is they want to do to awkwardly establish the characters. It just really doesn't work. So Nicolas Cage, now in the present, is a guy who's now, he's pushing 60, and he has, he's diagnosed with a form of dementia that will cause mood swings, paranoia, different rage instances, which... Why doesn't this movie work? It seems like Nicolas Cage could play this part in his sleep. So he is basically forced into retirement, and because of that, he's been chasing this terrorist for like 22 years, and the only person who's helping him out is another guy at the CIA who's Anton Yelchin, and before this disease takes over him, he wants to finally finish the job. He wants to hunt down this terrorist, and he wants to kill him. And that is not a bad story. It's not. You have this revenge movie with a guy who's throughout the movie dealing with dementia, whether or not some things are actually happening to him. And that's interesting. And I'm sure the script was. And I'm sure there might be a cut of this movie if Schrader was able to do what he wanted. It probably wouldn't be great, but I mean, it would definitely be better than what we got. A much more interesting way for me, anyway, that this story could have gone is if, as the viewer, if you're wondering if the guy he's chasing is even still alive, because people are telling him, they're like, oh no, like, this guy's dead, you know he's dead, and Cage's like, I didn't see his head, so I don't think he's dead. So that would be interesting, if you're following along with Cage, and you as well don't know if this guy's dead, or if Nicolas Cage's character is just being paranoid. But throughout the movie, you are shown what the terrorist is doing in some quick throwaway scenes. You see him throughout the film doing really nothing substantial. It would have been a much more interesting movie if it went that route. Especially because, boy, does the ending to this movie not work in any way, shape, or form. And that's kind of what I mean about this movie would have problems with its story regardless of what was done to it after it was shot. Unless there is some other ending that they shot, some other climax that they shot, then maybe. I don't know. I really, really don't know, but it definitely doesn't work. First of all, you have Nicolas Cage, who comes in contact with a doctor at one point, who is a doctor who is treating the terrorist, and that's kind of how they find him. And so Nicolas Cage is then sent undercover as this doctor, and then the only thing that they do to him is just simply put some glasses and a goatee on him. And then the terrorist later doesn't recognize him until he takes the glasses off and the goatee off. It's really ridiculous. And not to mention the fact that throughout the whole movie, when Nicolas Cage's character is tortured, there's like some scissors that are taken to his ear that leaves a pretty big cut and gash in his ear. So throughout a majority of the movie, he's wearing this special effects makeup fake ear to have this big scar on it, and it is wildly distracting. It makes him look like an alien. It makes him look like a Vulcan, or like half of him is from Star Trek. It doesn't work. He's got these big pieces that just kind of stick out like a sore thumb, and it's hard to take a lot of scenes seriously because of that. Especially in really dramatic sequences, because Cage's character is kind of a hard drinker in this. He's a hard drinker, he's dealing with this disease, he smokes a lot during the movie, and he's got sequences where he's showing some tears. There is some good dramatic work here, mixed in with some pretty awkward line delivery in a couple of takes that really seems like there are probably other takes that they should have used on certain lines. But that's not even just coming from Cage's character. That's a lot of the different performances in this film. Like, they just simply went with the first take that was on the reel. When it gets to the ending, Nicolas Cage is face to face with this terrorist, and his disease starts taking over, and you find out that the terrorist is also dying. He also has some kind of disease going on. And so Cage, they're face-to-face together, and Cage is there to kill him, but the two of them then just have this dialogue with each other that on the surface is kind of interesting. Like, that is an interesting way to go with it, in that what you think is going to be Cage going in there and stabbing him to death then turns into the two of them kind of just talking about their shit. That, okay, on paper, that might look fine. To a point, it's fine in the movie. Except when Cage just then gets up and leaves. Just leaves the guy there. This wanted terrorist who Cage is just like shared a moment with and then just leaves. At the end of the day, he's still a wanted terrorist who you just left alive in his like fucking apartment. What? Like, okay, even if you don't want revenge on this guy anymore, this man should probably not be free. And what happens after that is the guy then sends people to go kill Nicolas Cage. They're at the hotel swimming pool, and these guys with machine guns just show up and open fire on Cage and a bunch of different people, to where there is a lot of collateral damage here. A lot of just random people at this pool just up and get shot and killed. Yelchin takes one, like, in the arm. Cage takes one in the shoulder. It's like, dude, these deaths are on you, man. You probably should have killed this guy with your belt knife. Like, this is totally all your fault. Why did you just leave him there? What did you think was going to happen? I don't... This doesn't make a lot of sense. What is going on? And then so Cage then drives to the terrorist and is like, you missed me, motherfucker. And then he kills him. He kills him. He kills him in actually kind of a badass way. He kills him by just jamming his finger right into the guy's eye and into his brain, and he's just fucking killed dead. Motherfucker, you probably should have done this earlier. You would have saved a lot of lives if you did this earlier. You at least would have been doing your job if you did this earlier. You son of a bitch. And then he drives away, and his dementia hits, and he passes out at the wheel and veers off into a semi-truck that's coming right towards him. And then he dies. And the end. That's really stupid. I don't know how all of this last 20 minutes would have worked. Even if the movie was like a half hour longer and you had a lot more establishment with the characters and with their problems and all that. Like, again, it's sort of like, again, to go back to Serena, how in that movie you had characters and plot lines show up that seem like you already should have known about. And that's kind of the case here, especially when Cage meets a female friend of his, and you kind of feel like you already should be knowing this person or what their relationship, because it is just kind of sprung on you. The movie doesn't work, and it doesn't work in a much different way than something like Outcast or something like Left Behind, that just from beginning to end really just don't work at all. This one's a much sadder case, because you can tell that this was not a paycheck movie, that it wasn't. You can definitely tell that the people who made it, they really wanted something here. And maybe it'll be like Schrader's cut of Dominion, Exorcist the Beginning. Maybe it'll be like that. Maybe sometime there will be some cut of this movie that's better than this, that maybe looks like a Paul Schrader movie, that maybe looks and feels like a Schrader flick, like what it should look like. Maybe that'll happen. I doubt it, because I'm going to tell you right now, this butchered version of it is worse than Rennie Harlan's Exorcist the Beginning. Rennie Harlan's Exorcist the Beginning was a better sit than this. At least that movie was kind of entertaining. I don't even know how it could even be better than even Dominion, because even Schrader's cut of Dominion's not that great. I mean, it's a little better than Exorcist the Beginning. It's not a great film. It's an interesting movie, but it's not a great one. I don't recommend it. I don't. Cage completists like me, it's not a good one. You can see this spark there of what could have been, but maybe this upcoming movie that they're making where Jerry Lewis plays Nicolas Cage's father is going to be a much better movie than this, but this one doesn't work. All right, so I'll be back in a little bit.
Didn't anybody teach you to respect your elders?
Different situation, different measures.
No need to always get violent.
Do we understand each other? I will take that as a yes, we understand.
Hey, little lady, what's your major?
This guy's never gonna go to jail. He's got diplomatic immunity.
I'm an entrepreneur. I'm building an empire.
Let's go get those son of a bitches.
They're not your typical old guys. They're more like badasses. My turn now!
Somebody, please call Amber Lamps.
Lloyd wanted back in, which means he'll probably want out again in a couple of minutes. All right, get comfortable there, buddy. Okay, now I'm here to talk about Badass 2. Badasses. With the two Dannys. The two Danny Badasses. Danny Trejo and Danny Glover. Full disclosure, I've actually not seen the first one. I know what the first one is. I remember when it came out. There's really no reason why I didn't see the first one. I just didn't. It came and went, and I just never got around to seeing it, and I kind of just forgot about it. When I saw the poster for the first one, I remember kind of thinking, like, this movie seems like it exists just for the title and for the poster. Danny Trejo, badass. Like, is this even a movie? Like, or is this just like some Photoshop poster? So I didn't see the first one, so I can't, I don't know if this is better or worse than the first one. But the movie is, I wasn't expecting much going into this movie, and the movie's really not very good. But it was probably a little better than I thought it was going to be, in the sense that it is a little entertaining. It is what it is, man. It's Danny Trejo teams up with Danny Glover to crack some heads on the streets of L.A. and take down drug dealer Andrew Divoff, who's playing the same character he did in A Low-Down Dirty Shame. So right there, that tells you that at least the movie probably won't be boring. And it's not. It's dumb as shit. The movie is written and directed by Craig Moss, who seems to be known for doing two things: the badass movies and really, really awful spoof films. This is the guy who did Breaking Wind and The 41-Year-Old Virgin Who Knocked Up Sarah Marshall and Felt Super Bad About It. Am I getting that right? He had one that was just out that was 30 Days of Paranormal Activity with the Devil Inside the Girl with the Dragon Tattoo. One of those titles doesn't fucking belong. What the fuck? What? I don't even want to know. That's like if I did a spoof of religious movies and called it, Heaven Is For Real to Prove God's Not Dead by Saving Christmas with Birdman. What? I don't even want to know what that movie's like. Well, the religious spoof, I kind of want to know what that's like. That 30 days of what the fuck ever? No, I don't. It seems like Craig Moss is a lot more at home with a movie like this. Honestly, he probably would have been just fine as like a canon director in the 1980s. See, what did I tell you?
You want out again, buddy?
Or where'd you go? Well, he just disappeared. It's probably behind the couch. So, it's another episode of Brad talks about a movie and talks to his cat. So, well, there he is. You have teleportation, it seems. And I'm not surprised by this in any way, shape, or form. Sneaky bastard. So, he probably would have been right at home doing a canon movie in the 1980s. In fact, if this was a canon movie in the 1980s, it'd look a lot better than this movie does, because this movie, the effects aren't good. It looks like shit. There's CGI blood. There's CGI, like, breath coming from their mouths when they're in a freezer, which just don't even do that. Like, it is way more distracting to have the CGI breath in the freezer than it is if you just didn't put the breath there at all. I probably wouldn't have even noticed if they just didn't put it in there at all. Or if I did, I wouldn't have given a shit about it, really. But then you have, like, fucking After Effects coming out of their mouth and shit like that. It looks dumb. Danny Trejo is, he runs, like, a boxing training studio, and his protege, who's like a son to him, I don't know if he was in the first one or not, he ends up getting killed by some drug dealers, so Trejo then wants revenge on the people who killed him. And Danny Glover is crotchety old Danny Glover, who is agoraphobic and just hangs out inside of his convenience store until some hoodlums burst in, and then Danny Glover has to save the day with a hockey stick, and now he's okay to go outside and fucking kick some ass. He dealt with this fast. And he also is dying. He's dying of a liver disease, and he needs a liver transplant, but he can't get it because, I'm not even kidding, there's a line in the movie where he says, "I'm too old for a liver transplant." That's a sad version of his trademark line. That line doesn't make me laugh at all. That just makes me cry. And he's constantly referred to as, like, the grumpy old man, like this crotchety old dude, even though I believe technically he is younger than Danny Trejo. But he does look older. He does look older than Danny Trejo. And that's... I don't know what to say much about the movie. There's really not much to say about it. I'll say that Danny Trejo and Danny Glover, they do work good together in the movie. They're having some fun in it. It's fun to see grumpy-ass Danny Glover just beat the shit out of people. And Danny Trejo, he's really good in this. He plays a very likable character in this film. He's got good chemistry with this little girl in the movie that he's kind of watching out for. The movie's predictable as shit. Throughout the movie, she talks about how she wants a secret room in her closet, so he builds her one, because you know later on in the movie, some of the bad guys are going to break into this house, and she is going to hide in her secret room, and that is what happens. And then Trejo then kind of hooks up with this woman who's the mother of the child, and I wasn't sure if she was the mother of the kid who was killed at the beginning, or the girlfriend wife, because they kind of look the same age. This guy who's... I hope it's a wife. I hope it is, because the guy who's a son to Danny Trejo is now dead, and Danny Trejo wants revenge, and he's also going to bang his wife. Or his widow. I kind of missed that. I'm not sure, but... So, Danny, he plays a very likable character in this movie. He just simply plays, like, a good dude who will fucking kick your ass if you fuck with his shit. In that regard, I mean, he's a much better character in this. Completely more three-dimensional and a lot more charismatic than he was in Machete Kills. I actually like this movie better than Machete Kills. This felt more like a movie than Machete Kills did, as opposed to just, like, a parody reel. Lloyd... That's not your Dawn of the Dead poster. Well, it's yours now. You break it, you bought it. So then it gets to this. This is the second time in a row I'm talking about a movie that has a ridiculous ending, but in this case, it was, like, kind of funny. In this case, it was totally just kind of funny. So at the end of the movie, they're face-to-face with Andrew Dimoff, who really should have been in this movie more. He's, like, kind of the main bad guy in it, and they can't touch him because he has diplomatic immunity. Seriously. This is the second best Danny Glover movie that has to do with that. So anyway, his Dimoff's like son is sort of the other guy who's in charge of this gang, and he's in the movie way more than Andrew Dimoff is. And that's unfortunate, because Dimoff is way better than this guy is. When you're watching this dumb young guy who's supposed to be, like, this bad guy really not be threatening at all, and then you're constantly just wanting Andrew Dimoff to be on the screen more, because he just plays a much better bad guy. So at the end of the movie, there's this chase. There's this Bronco chase, and in this action sequence, I'm looking at it like, this action sequence isn't that bad. I mean, it kind of is, but it isn't. There's some shots in this chase scene that are a little more ambitious looking than the rest of the shit in this movie. And then I figured out why. Because I started realizing that this looks really, really familiar. And it did. Because this movie has an action sequence in it that is made up of the Bronco chase from the Gene Hackman movie Narrow Margin. That's just simply spliced right there in the movie. And boy, you can tell. Because suddenly it goes from looking like a movie that was made in, like, 1990 to looking like a Craig Moss film. You can tell. You can tell in a lot of different ways. One, because the quality looks a lot different. And also, suddenly there's now, in some exterior shots, there is now a white person driving the car instead of Danny Glover, and there is also something sticking up in the back seat that made sense in Narrow Margin, not in this movie, when there is nothing in the back seat when it's cutting to Danny Glover and Danny Trejo in the car together. Apparently they had the rights to use some clips from Narrow Margin, and they took full advantage of that. And it is probably the better action sequence in the movie, because it looks like an action sequence from a much better movie. And then at the end, the cops show up, and some other bad guys, and Danny Trejo gets into, like, a fist fight with Andrew Dufresne. And they're just kind of wailing on each other. And Trejo just beats the shit out of him. Just keeps punching, beating the shit out of him. And then Dufresne falls back and is like, says something. And you're like, okay, well, he just knocked him the fuck out. All right. And then he goes to talk to some cops. And then they put their fingers on Andrew Dufresne's neck. And they're like, he's dead. What? Danny Trejo just beat him to death. Okay, so he just beat the shit out of him to death. That's how the bad guy dies in this movie. What seems like it is an accident that he accidentally beat this man to death. But then it gets better, because they realize that the bad guy's now dead, and then Danny Glover says, oh my god, I've now found my liver transplant! Don't just stand there, get this man's body on ice! So Danny Glover's life is now saved, because they're gonna take the villain's liver and give it to Danny Glover, because I guess that is how that works. Cut to ending scene in which Danny Glover has now hooked up with a 20-year-old college student. That's how this movie ends. Ew. I mean, good for him, but what the fuck? So, do I recommend this movie? It's not a very good movie. It's even the one-liners are dumb in a way that's really not cheerfully dumb, just kind of dumb. Like, we got one badass, now we're dealing with two badasses. Okay. You know what? At the end of the day, you're watching a movie with Danny Trejo and Danny Glover just beating the shit out of people for like 90 minutes, and Andrew Dufresne is the bad guy, and the fight scenes are, I mean, they're not spectacularly shot, but they're, it's not like looking at something like, what was it, Kill Switch with Steven Seagal. It's got that really fucking bad fight scene in it where it's somebody else and just his face is spliced in there. It's not like that. When Danny Trejo is wailing on a dude, it looks like Danny Trejo wailing on a dude. If you're surfing around on Netflix and you come across this, fine. Like, okay, like, yeah, if it was late at night and I need something on TV when I'm kind of winding down for the night and I come across something like this, okay, then it would serve its purpose. All right. It would be a much cooler movie if it was made about 20 or 30 years ago. But as it is, I thought it was going to be way worse than what it was. So take that however you want it.
Dad always said that God has a perfect plan for everyone. Do you ever think you might end up in hell instead of heaven?
Are you trying to impress? Run around trying to help this girl?
Just trying to help her, Mom.
You better go. How come you're not with her?
I've messed a lot of things up, Grace.
There's still time.
I just hope you're all keeping safe out there. You're surrounded by your families.
Hold on. Hold on, Grace.
It's coming.
Oh, and I also forgot to mention that in Badass 2, Badasses, Danny Trejo sticks buffed out cokehead college frat boy Jonathan Lipnicki's dick in a rotating fan blade. So that happened in the movie. Kind of surprised I forgot about that. Anyway, now we can talk about the apocalypse, because we got the apocalypse movie, These Final Hours, which is like a... It's a pre-apocalypse movie. Like, the world is just about to end. Not quite, but just about. It's taking place on the last day before, I believe it's a bunch of different asteroids are hitting the Earth. And this is an Australian film. And other countries and continents have already been destroyed. It just hasn't hit. It just hasn't hit Australia yet. And like they mentioned, like Canada's already gone, and a few other places. And the main character in the movie is Jimmy, who's this dude. It's not that he's necessarily like a bad guy. He's just this self-absorbed young dude. You know, he drinks, he does drugs, he just kind of sleeps around, and that's it. It kind of comes across like he's a little bit of a loner in that regard, and he's left this girl who is pregnant, and he wants to spend his remaining time on Earth at this party that's the end, like, the party of all parties. It's the ultimate end-of-the-world party. You know, fuck it. The world's about to end. We are all about to fucking die. Let's just fucking go out on top. We're gonna fucking drink. We're gonna get loaded. Orgies. All of that. So he's on his way to this party, and he ends up saving the life of this young girl who's captured by a few guys, and it kind of seems like she's probably about to get raped. Either that, or they're just going to straight up murder her, or both. So he ends up saving this girl, and he reluctantly saves her. I mean, he does, because like I said at the beginning, he's not a bad guy, he's just a self-obsessed guy. So yeah, he sees this girl who gets captured, so yeah, he's going to do something about it. And now the two of them are kind of tagging along together, and he decides he's gonna end up taking her to her dad. That's where she was trying to go. She was trying to get to her father, and she wants to be with her father when the world ends. Hang on. Come on in, buddy. Lloyd, I was just kidding about the world ending. It's fine. Things are gonna be fine. But unless you know something differently, because the animals are always the first to know. You're fine. Okay, so where was I? Oh yeah, end of the world talk. Even though there's like all these asteroids and stuff going around, part of me wants to believe that this is all taking place simultaneously with the events in like the last sequences from Knowing, the Nicolas Cage movie Knowing. Because that was an awesome scene of just fucking pandemonium and shit, like fucking Beethoven playing, and the world's all gone to fucking shit, the city's destroyed, Cage is fucking riding through there, and like it's the end times, it's amazing. Anyway, I don't hate that movie as much as a lot of other people do, but okay, anyway, back to these final hours. It would be really funny if they were taking place in the same universe. Oh, and when the little girl dies, she'll be fine. She'll just go off to, like, Angel Planet or whatever. So, alright. Anyway, they do actually end up at this party. The party to end all parties. And it is pretty fucking insane. Like, the orgies, drugs, drinking, like, all of that. Like, it's the end of the world. Fuck it. There's a fucking Russian roulette competition. There's a Russian roulette competition that's going on. And Sarah Snook from Predestination pops up in this movie. She's fucking great in this movie, too. She pops up as this crazy woman who's at the end of the world party who thinks that the little girl is her own daughter and, like, is following her and stalking her and shit. It's pretty fucking heartbreaking. This movie is crazy fucking good. This is a really, really badass, cool movie. I believe it was actually made a couple of years ago. I mean, it was released in Australia way before we got it. We just got it here in the States. And I highly recommend this. This is really, really cool, bleak, 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 gut-wrenching filmmaking. Like, there's some really beautiful shit in this film. One, it's great to see these two characters, the dude and the little girl, interact with each other. They are both great in this movie. The guy is the guy from Wolf Creek. They are fantastic together in this movie. It's great seeing his transformation from this self-absorbed guy to someone who by the end of the movie, even though the world is about to end, he's running to, like, be with his girlfriend right before the fucking world ends. I mean, it's beautiful. The movie doesn't pull any punches. It doesn't go for any kind of cheap ending or anything like that. I mean, there's some disturbing shit in this movie while simultaneously being gorgeous. When this fucking thing crashes into the ocean, I mean, it's a really gorgeous shot at the end of the film. I mean, you're rooting for this guy to get to his destination, even though you know how this is gonna end. You just kind of want it to end well for him in these final few moments, like, on a personal level. I mean, there's some gut-wrenching shit here. Like, at the party, when people are coked out of their heads and they think that they've found safety in this underground concrete bunker that they made, and they're fucking flipping out. I mean, they grasp onto anything to try to keep some level of sanity, to maybe try to talk themselves into the fact that maybe they might live when this happens. And the dude is like, no, this isn't, you would need a bunker that's like thousands of fucking feet or miles deep. This ain't gonna fucking work. We are all gonna fucking die. And it's cool. It's not something like The Purge, where there's just a bunch of anarchy going on in the streets. And there's some of that. Because that's how he finds the girl. I mean, there's a little bit of that. But for the most part, streets are actually relatively empty here. I mean, not that a lot of this is taking place, like, in the midst of, like, a big city. You see, like, a smoldering city in the background and stuff like that. But where this movie is primarily taking place, streets are kind of empty and isolated. I don't know if that was like a budget issue, but when you watch the movie, a lot of these people have killed themselves. Like, there's bodies hanging from streetlights. Dude finds his sister and her husband, like, naked in the shower, having committed suicide. And then later on, he meets up with his mom, who is still alive, but he can't tell her, my sister's dead. It's kind of this journey about closure, like, because he has closure with his mom, he has closure with his girlfriend. She, by the end of it, has a little closure in her dad, so to speak. I mean, there's some really sad shit in this movie. And so, like, streets are really empty because a lot of people are just simply off to themselves. And that was, I think that was an interesting way to go with it, as opposed to, okay, it being like The Purge, even though The Purge isn't at the end of the world, but you know what I mean? Like, all that, like, apocalypse violence and shit like that. Or honestly, even like in Knowing, like, when there was this fucking crazy ass shit going on in the streets. Granted, I mean, that was taking place in the middle of the city, but I liked the really low-budget feel of the movie. I liked the isolated feel of the movie. This is a really, 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 really damn good movie. And I honestly kind of hope that towards the beginning of this video, you actually stopped it to watch it, because I pretty much gave a lot of shit away about it. Although maybe you didn't, because I think it took me a while to say whether or not I liked the movie. But I loved it. I really, really, really loved this movie. And yeah, when I was talking about Badass 2, I was like, yeah, this is kind of bad, but if you find it on Netflix, whatever. If you haven't seen this movie, don't waste your time watching some throwaway thing like Badass 2. Watch this. Between the three movies I watched, the Nick Cage movie, Badass 2, and this, this is damn good. This is one of the coolest sits I've had so far this year. And I know we're only three months into the year, but man, this movie rocked my shit. It's well acted, it's well directed. I'm really looking forward to other things that this director does. I'm looking forward to other things the writer does. Both of it, I believe it's the same guy who wrote and directed it, but it's a top-notch, suspenseful, really gut-wrenching movie. So totally check this one out.